Good morning to everybody. Today we are going to take into consideration the second part of what is dealing with human vision, and in particular today we will take into consideration in this lecture number 7, colorimetry. So let's start with this topic. So just start with an introduction and the limits of a psychological nature inherent in the process of perception require a specification of color through objective type attributes that allow us to define in a unique and quantitative way what we perceive in a subjective and qualitative manner as chromatic sensation. So colorimetry is the science that deals with methods for measuring color based on the relationships between energy interactions with materials and the physiology of human vision, defining reference standards for which the definition and exact reproduction of a certain color. We have already seen how the colors physically correspond to the result of the interaction of electromagnetic energy with the world around us in the form of reflected, transmitted, and remitted energy in the visible range, read and interpreted by the human eyes, perceives as a unique event. In fact, each color corresponds to a radiant flow curve that represents not a single value, but infinite spectral information dependent on two external factors, such as the nature of the observed surface and the characteristics of the luminant and an internal one, which is the human perception. So, I mean, right now, for our remote sensing course, we definitely need to define in a quantitative way the characteristics of the chromatic sensations. And so we need, using the colorimetry, to measure colors. And we need that, of course, because you already saw in the labs that we are looking at colored images. So we need to understand which are the rules and how we can measure the colors independently from the fact that these colors are formed by different spectral bands. But of course, it's necessary. And we need to, as is stated here at the end of this introduction, we need to understand how the surfaces that we are observing are reflecting or emitting energy. And so we need to measure this energy and to take into consideration which is the characteristics of the illuminant. So that means of the energy that is striking over these surfaces in order to check in which spectral bands of the visible is reflecting energy. So, I mean, which is the dominant in order to fully understand which is the dominant color of the reflection or of the emission. But at the same time, these things that is quite simple, so to measure the characteristics and the quantity of the reflected or emitted energy, because you remember, we can do it in a quite easily way. What is very difficult is just to, after having measured this quantity of energy, we need to understand which is the relationship between what is going to strike to our constant rods, to our detectors that are placed on the retina, and how this energy is affecting the human perception, because this is something that is dealing with the physiological aspects of the human vision. Therefore, a color measurements must take these factors into account simultaneously, while the reference to only one of them will offer an incomplete and unsatisfactory description. The clearest proof of this lies in the fact that different radiant flows curves can correspond to perfectly identical impressions of color or stimuli. This phenomenon is known as metamerism, and the colors that show these features are called metamer colors. In essence, giving a radiant flux curve, that is phi lambda, the eye is not able to read all the information contained as the wavelength varies, but perceives of it in a global results, a cumulative value from which it derives precisely the color impression, better known as stimulus value or tristimulus, if we consider the trichromatic model of perception. So what does it mean? It doesn't mean that, we can measure the energy that, for example, is reflected by a surface simply measuring the energy that is reflected in a range of wavelengths comprised between 0.4 to 0.7 microns in the visible. Because, of course, I forgot to mention at the beginning, in these colorimetry topics, we are dealing only with the visible part of the electromagnetic spectrum. So we can measure this energy, and for example, having just a simple diagram in which in the x-axis we have, as usual, wavelengths ranging from 0.4 to 0.7 microns. And for example, in the y-axis we have our raw coefficient that is ranging from 0 to 1, or we have a total radiance measured, of course we will have a curve that is expressing for a particular surface the way in which in the different wavelength this surface is reflecting energy, and simply calculating the integral between 0.4 to 0.7 of this curve, so that means to measure all the area that is subtended by this curve, we can calculate the total amount of energy, that is radiance, that is reflected by this surface. And of course we can have, our eye, and in particular our sensors, are not able to distinguish the dominant, but they will get a total sensation of colors, taking into consideration all the energy that is reflected. And so it's not perceiving the dominant wavelengths that corresponds, as I mentioned in the previous lecture, as a particular color, but but perceive this energy as a global result, so a cumulative value, from which our brain essentially derives a color impression that is known as tristimulus value, that I will explain later on. So if we are taking into consideration example of metamerism, in order just to simplify the topics, a very simple example is that the same objects appear to be different colors depending on the light source. So I mean, one of these examples is that we have the same object, but reflecting in different way the energy, because the energy, the illuminant is changing, it appears to our eyes to be dissimilar. So let's say these things here. You see that we have a sofa, we have a wall, and the scene is always the same, but we are changing the lights that are illuminating this scene. And so, for example, starting from the look at the mouse from the left part of the three figures, so with the figures that is on the left, this is this scene is illuminated by a direct sunlight, while here in the center we have indirect sunlight. That means that the energy of the sunlight is striking over another surface and then reflected in the scene. And then here you see we have artificial light. You see they are all the same, they are always the same scene, but you see that considering the different energy in which this scene is placed, it appears to our eyes to be very different. And from here, you can just get a very important things that is related to what we mentioned in the previous lecture, that out of these three different figures, apart of course the artificial lights that seems to be darker than the other two, you see that the image in which we have an illumination coming from a direct sunlight, I mean the image appears to be better than the other two. Why that? Because the sensitivity, as we've seen, of human eyes on the human perception is in some way adapted, has been adapted in some way during the evolutionary process to the emission of the sun. So I mean, for example, in this left image, we can better recognize colors than in the other two, because, for example, in the middle, in the middle figure, you see there's a yellowish tone that is coming to the scene. Well, here we can recognize better colors, and at the end, we can perceive better the scene. So that means that the human eyes is adapted to this particular electromagnetic energy that is the direct sunlight, so how the sun is emitting energy. And so you see, this is an example of metamerism. That means that the same object, depending on how they are illuminated, they are perceived by our eyes in a very different way. Okay, let's go on. The curve in the following figure, for example, describes, as I mentioned before, when talking about the way in which a surface is reflecting in the visible, and the following figures describes, in terms of reflectivity rho, the spectral behavior of a red panel illuminated by a daylight and read through the detectors of a colorimeter. So that means that in the following figures, we will see a diagram in which a surface, a red panel that is red and is illuminated by a direct sunlight light, and is this energy that is emitted is acquired by an artificial detector, an artificial sensor such as a colorimeter. Although the curve itself includes a detailed description of the spectral trend of the surface observed over the whole visible spectrum, it appears evident that the instrument's eye will not perceive a global impression of red colors, because a general absorption occurs in the part of the spectrum with greater value or reflection starting from 0.6 microns in orange and red. On the other hand, the same curve says nothing about the typology of such a red. It is impossible to know from the spectral curve how intense or brilliant the color it represents will appear to our eyes. So let's check this particular curve. So this is a red colored panel in a natural daylight condition, and you see we mentioned this type C source. Fix that in mind, because after a few slides we will see the characteristics of this source of illumination. This is the type C1, and in this diagram it shows the radiant flux curve that the eye perceives as a resultant global effect based on three main stimuli of sensitivity in red, green, and blue. So you see, I'm sorry, this is still in Italian. This is pannello rosso, means red panel, and here we have wavelengths, you see, ranging around 0.4 to 0.7. That means this is roughly the visible, and here we have the rho coefficient ranging from 0 to 1, and this is how the reflectance coefficient rho is changing over the wavelengths. So that means that if this is a red panel and this is illuminated by a source, the In luminance source, the type C that is very similar to the direct sunlight. I mean, let's in this way first understand how the colors, the impression of colors is formed in our eyes. If this panel is red, of course, this reflectance coefficient will be maximum in the range of 0.6 to 0.7 microns. I mean, it reflects more energy. Well, you see, from 0.4 to around 0.6, this panel is absorbing energy. So the result is that it is reflecting all the energy in red, and so it appears to be red to the eye. And so, what is supposed here is that you remember we have cones and rods, and especially cones that are in charge for the photopic vision are very sensitive. The hypothesis is that they are very sensitive in their three different forms to the red, green, and blue components of the visible. And so they were activated, the rhodopsin are activated by the components of the striking energy of the sensor coming from what we are observing. So, I mean, in this way, we have three different components, but when these stimulus through a variation of tension, of electric tension, comes to the brain, I mean, what the brain is getting is the total amount of energy. That means the area that is subtended under this curve, so the integrals. So this is the quantity of energy. Let's substitute, for example, in order to understand here, to the raw coefficient to a radiance. So that will be a total radiance that is coming to the brain in diff coming from different sensor, and so the brain will understand and will have the sensation because it's a sensation. Pay attention to that. It's a sort of sense. It will the brain looking at this red panel will have the sensation of a red color. All right, let's go on. In order to carry on the topics, we need to mention how we can define a color. And there are three conditions that are color, purity, and intensity that allow to attain the complete parameterization of the colors. So, in order to quantify a particular color, so in order to define numerically the infinite colors that our eyes can perceive, we need to define parameters, and there are three parameters that are color, purity, and intensity. So, what we mean with color? I'm sorry. The color, that is the first parameter, corresponds to the wavelength of spectral colors, such as violet, blue, red, or so on, to which the values of three stimulus transmitted to the brain are associated. The color is the basic component of a color and corresponds to the chromatic sensation. On the one hand, is assume a physiological meaning, association of a color to specific region of the spectrum, and on the other, it becomes a very precise physical quantity, definition of the associated wavelength. In essence, if several people can agree on the impression of a color, for example, on the fact that the panel in question is red instead of green, it is more difficult to decide which is the exact red color observed with respect to the infinite color contained in the spectrum. So, let's recap the important things of the definition of color. When we are talking about a colorimetric system, one of the most important parameters is, of course, the color. What is the meaning of color? The color is what intended as in the way of colors. For example, when I mention in blue, red, green, violet, purple, maroon, or different colors, I mention in this concept. And this concept has associated two different meaning. The first one is the definition of a psychological meaning, that the term of the color, the facts, and pay attention to that when I'm meaning, when I'm just saying red color, everybody of you have a sensation of what red is, because this is a sensation that we have since the beginning of our life. I mean, till when we are very young, we had a sensation of red. And for example, we have also a sensation of green, for example. And we had a sensation, we have a sensation of blue. So I mean, human beings have already a sensation of colors. And this is the first aspect. But pay attention, because this sensation of colors is very limited. Because I mean, for example, everybody have a sensation of the three principles. That means red, green, and blue. Everybody, when I'm saying these three colors, red, green, and blue, have a precise sensation of what red and green and blue are. And for example, talking about complementary that we mentioned in the previous lectures, of course, everybody has a very strong sensation of what a yellow is. Because I mean, we have a very strong sensation because when we are staring at the sun in a very clear day, I mean, we saw the sun yellowish just because it's emitting most part of the energy with a maximum in the yellow with a yellow dominant. But for example, the sensation that we have for colors is very limited because I mean, for example, for me, and maybe it's true also for you, the sensation of magenta and cyan is not so strong as red. And for example, I have a very poor sensation of other colors, for example. Let's say that I have not a specific sensation on what purple is, and I don't have a very strict sensation in correspondence, for example, with the sensation that I have for green or violet, for example. So I mean, you see, we have a sensation, a color sensation, that is something that we have since the beginning of our life, and this is the first part of what we can get for a color. So the sensation that this color gives to our brain. But the second part, that is what we can measure, is the physical quantity of energy that we are dealing with. And so, for example, if I'm going back in this red panel, I saw that here the maximum energy is reflected from 0.6 to 0.7. And so, I mean, this is the dominant color in which this surface is reflecting energy. So if I'm measuring, I saw that most part on all the part of the radiance that is reflected, the area that is subtended under these curves, are coming from this interval. So that means that from the quantitative point of view, of course, this color will be a red one. All right. So the color is the first parameter, the first important parameter. The second parameter is what is called purity, or better, saturation of a color. On the other hand, this saturation indicates how much a color observed differs from its corresponding saturated or pure or spectral colors, as it is determined by these colors. In practice, the lights observed in nature are hardly monochromatic. That is, they can be associated perfectly with a single wavelength. Instead, they are mostly multichromatic, that if is they contain a different number of wavelengths, although they can be grouped in a particular neighborhood, as in the example of the panel. With certain limits, the dominant color remains unchanged, even if the spectral range considered increase. What changes is the impression of the dominant hue and becomes, in a certain sense, increasing, faded, and less certain, moving away from the dominant wavelength until, at the extreme, any hue is lost and the fall of colors, and one enters the achromatic dimension, where precisely it no longer makes sense to speak of colors but of simple luminous intensity. That is, one enters the world of grays. So what is the purity of saturation? Let's go back to the diagram. You see, this is a color, a red color. It appears to be a red color that is not perfectly saturated. That means that if you look at the Y scale, you see we have the raw coefficient that is ranging, as I mentioned before, I'm sorry, from 0 to 1. And here you see the maximum is 0.5. So that means that this is not a red color perfectly saturated, but has half the saturation, because the reflection coefficient is 0.5. Considering that this red panel is an opaque surface, so the transmission coefficient is of course zero, equal to zero, if the here in the red part of the spectrum the reflectance coefficient is 0.5, that means that the alpha coefficient, the absorption coefficient, will be 0.5, of course. So the red saturated colors will have these curves in which from 0.6 to 0.7 the reflectance coefficient will be equal to 1, and this is the most saturated, this is the saturated color, okay, of the is a saturated red. So is something that is represented here, look at the mouse, above the 0.5 reflectivity range. So this is not a saturated color, and concept of saturation, this is a red color saturated at 50% of the total possible saturation. So I mean, whatever red colors is ranging in an infinity of saturation that is going through the maximum quantity of energy that can reflect the red surface, that is equal to a rho equal to 1, to rho equal to 0, that will be black, of course. From black to a maximum red saturated colors, we have in between only an infinite range of red colors in using the first parameter, that is the color, with different degree of saturation. The maximum saturation is rho equal to 1, the minimum saturation, of course, is rho equal to 0. All right. Which is the third parameter that we are interested in? The third parameter is what is called the intensity of a color. The last of the three parameters refers to the amount of reflected light energy. So you can have the same colors and therefore equivalent in their chromatic components of hue and saturation, which appear more or less bright, more or less dark. This also depends on the different spectral sensitivity of the human eye. So the colors that appear first and therefore even brighter are those of green-yellow around 0.55. The intensity essentially expresses the achromatic component of the observed color, regardless of its hue and saturation, which are instead the chromed components, which... For example, the brown color of chocolate in all respects show the same hue that is a dominant around 0.58 microns and saturation of an orange yellow, almost like an orange, but with a decidedly much lower intensity value. So the color factor is perceptible only within certain limits. On the contrary, for very high intensity values, as you can guess, no particular colors can prevail, and the saturation tends to be minimal, so that it no longer makes sense to talk about color. So I mean, going back again to the red panel, I mean what we mentioned right now, the intensity, I mean is the quantity of energy that can be measured. And in this case, you see, this area is representing a red color because it's all the energy is reflected in a range of 0.6, 0.7 microns. I'm sorry. And the saturation is the area that is subtended by this curve, and the intensity is the total amount of energy, radiance, that is registered and is reflected by this panel. Of course, if I have a larger intensity, that means that these panels is reflecting with a larger reflectivity coefficient rho. Of course, there will be more area subtended by this area by these curves, and so at the parity of colors, because the colors is the same, it's red, we will have a larger saturation. Because I mean the rho is bigger than that one, and of course we will have what? We will have, I'm sorry, we will have a larger intensity. So in this case, same color, because it's always red, changing the rho value, so the reflectance coefficient and then the total radiance measured, same color, different saturation, and of course different intensity. All right, so talking about that, we mentioned the three characteristics, and now we need to introduce the CIE colorimetric system. So the first necessary step for the definition of a normalized colorimetric method was to quantify the different reactivities of the three photoreceptor systems of the human eye during the perceptive action of a given color. You remember the three cones, the three different cones that seems because it's not really sure, but taking into consideration the Young and Helmholtz theory, these three photoreceptors, these three types of cones, seems to be in charge for the acquisition of energy in the three different subbands of the visible, red, green, and blue. This requires various experiments, among which we recall the most famous of Stiles, Bartsch, and Speranskaya, which revealed the reactivity of a population of individuals considered to have a normal vision through the stimulation provoked by various C colors of the spectrum, put in direct comparison with the other colors, obtaining according to Young model for additive synthesis of three monochromatic beams based on a theme of primary colors, the red, that is the RS color, the green, that is the VS color, and the blue, that is the blue S color, the blue X flux, chosen appropriately. Figure below. So, just introducing the CIE colorimetric system, I mean, there were many different experiments, and all the experiments, the Stiles, Bartsch, and Speranskaya, was based on the facts that they measure the sensitivity of many individuals tested. just with a simple method. So they projected on a particular screen a color out of the infinite colors we can define and in which our eyes is sensitive, and then with a particular system that we will see right after this slide, it's in the figures, they will try to reproduce the unknown colors in order, out of all these individuals, to understand if there's a particular method, a quantitative method, in order to measure the characteristics from the numerical point of view of the unknown color. So let's check these very simple things here. So you see, I mean, on the same screen, there were a projector that were, was a projector project was project on the screen this color, this CC color that is the unknown colors, and then after on the screen under these colors they try to reproduce the same color using these three different projectors. What are these three different projectors? As you see, they are very similar to the projector that we are using in a classroom, and the screen on which it's projected these beams are really similar to the screen that we have in our classroom at the Politecnico, and these three different projectors are emitting a very whitish light. They have a very whitish lamp, so it's emitting a very white color. And on the objective of these three projectors, it's all these objectives are filtered by three different filters: a red filter, a green filter, and a blue filter. That means they are projecting three different fluxes that are red, green, and blue. Which is the difference between this projector and what we are using in a classroom? That these projectors can change the quantity of energy that the lamp is emitting. So we have a sort of potentiometer, a power meter, that can change the quantity of energy emitted. So, for example, if we are taking into consideration the projector that is emitting a red flux, changing the quantity of energy of the white light that is emitted and is filtered by this red filter. And what is a red filter? It's a filter of a red color. That means that it's absorbing all the energy emitted by the lamp, the inner lamp of the projector in the blue and in the green wavelengths, and the filter is it's has a transmission coefficient that is equal to 1 only from 0.6 to 0.7, so it's passing only this part of the energy, and all the other is acquired, is absorbed. That means that on the screen you will see a red color projected, and so if I'm changing the quantity of energy of the white lamps, the results is that I'm changing the saturation of the color of the red. So changing the quantity of energy, I'm changing the saturation. So the maximum energy will be a saturated color, and when I'm decreasing the quantity, I will have again a red color, but with a less saturation. So that means that there's less energy emitted in this wavelength, in these wavelengths comprised between 0.6 and 0.7. And of course, it's the same for the other two projectors. So if I'm changing on the three projectors the quantity of energy, and just changing the quantity, there will be a way to reproduce with these three beams the unknown colors. And so that means that When this color, the unknown color, is similar to what I'm reproducing, changing the emissivity of the three projector in the three primary colors, all the individuals that are tested, they will get the fact that these two colors are equal. So the sensation of the equality of the colors. So when these colors are considered to be the same, it's enough to read the quantity of the power meters of the three different projectors. For example, if we have here a scale ranging between 0 and 100 for the three different projectors, that is a scale of the emitted white light emitted. I mean, I can read a triplet of values. For example, let's say 100, 10, and 10, and of course, this is a triplet of colors, so a triplet of numbers that are identifying in a unique and quantitative way the characteristics of this color. That of course, if the triplet is 100, 10, 10, is a sort of reddish color with a very a really poor quantity of green and blue. So this is the first way in which they tried to measure the quantity of the colors. So the scheme, this is the scheme that I introduce for the reproduction of a color that is based on the experimental determination of these three stimulus coefficients. So we have three different projectors, and our eyes, and in particular our three kinds of cones, are stimulated in a different way based on the three different subcomponents of the visible, the red, the green, and the blue. And that's why this system is based on what is called three stimulus coefficient. So the stimuli that we have in the three subspectral bands of the visible. So the results of these experiments are represented in the following figures by these three functions that are called RS, GS, and BS, called three stimulus of color matching. We describe the necessary paths computed on all the spectrum of the visible and relative to the three red, green, and blue primaries used as the synthesis. This function and these other functions, you see blue, green, and red, this function therefore represent the key to realize the information transfer between the external physical reality of color and the internal perceptive reality of the human eyes. So you have to we have to mention, I'm sorry, the facts that, I mean, these three curves that are you see on the wavelength, on the X, we have again, of course, wavelengths ranging from 0.4 to 0.7. Here I have these three stimuli. You see, these three diagrams are exactly the way in which we can transfer some a physical behavior, that in this case is the way in which this panel in that particular illumination condition is reflecting energy, and how this energy in the three different ba in the th by the three different kind of cones we have is converted into a color sensation. And you see, these are the three stimulus in which you see the blue, the green, and the red are in some part of the spectrum overlapped. And I have to mention, since now, that you see one of the problem is that things here, look at the mouse, the fact that in the red, it seems that the cones that is sensitive to the red channel seems to have a negative sensation. And you mean, I mean, negative sensation is something that is difficult to deal with. So it means it's something that is related to the possibility not to have a red stimuli, but to subtract a red stimuli from the green and from the blue. So it's something that is quite annoying in our case to have a negative sensation that is relative, and just to give you an example, to the fact that it's not the energy that is giving us a color sensation, but it's something like to energy that is giving and is taking off from our sensation the sensation of red. You see, here in these spectral bands, we have in the red in the red part of the cones, in the red kind of cones, I mean, we have a negative sensation. So that means that it is subtracting energy to the red in order to balance the blue and the green. All right. It's important to underline that the tristimulus diagrams are linked to the spectral characteristics of the primaries chosen in the reference system, of course. In the specific case, the trichromatic model was adopted, and the three monochromatic beams used were chosen with wavelengths equals to 0.64 for the red, 0.52 around for the green, and 0.44 for the blue. So I mean, that means that of course we need to choose out of the infinite numbers of blue, green, and red, one particular red, one particular green, and one particular blue. And in this case, I'm sorry, they were chosen these three colors with they have a dominant wavelength that is represented by these three quantities. If the references were changed, the results would obviously be different, of course. Therefore, the choice of primary colors is a very important factor and should be done with the criterion that each of them is a color that cannot be reproduced through the synthesis of the other two. So, I mean, the concept of principal colors is simply that. I mean, I can use whatever color I want as primary color. That means that also if I'm using, I don't know, red, blue, and brown, I can reproduce an infinite quantity of colors. But the rules is that I need to use and I should use as primary a color that cannot be reproduced through the synthesis of the other two. So I mean, using these three colors, I cannot reproduce the blue using and mixing red and green, and I cannot reproduce the red just mixing only green and blue. This is the ratio for which these three primary colors were chosen. So, these results, obtained experimentally, showed two problematic aspects due to the specific spectral sensitivity of the cones in the human retina, namely, the impossibility of obtaining the white color with equal weights of tristimulus RS, GS, and BS, contrary to the assumption of the starting trichromatic model. So the starting assumption of the trichromatic model was that we can reproduce whatever color we want. In this case, it was noted that it was impossible to obtaining the white color using these three primary colors. And the second problematic aspect was what I mentioned before, the presence of negative values of tristimulus due to the behavior of the function of the red, the RS in lambda, in the spectral range of the blue-red between the wavelengths of the two primaries, green and blue, contrary to the hypothesis of starting only sums on the three monochromatic beams. So I mean, in the trichromatic system that were starting to think of as the resolving system in order to quantify the characteristics of the colors, I mean, having a negative stimulus, of course, is contrary to the assumption to only sum three monochromatic beams in the three principles in order to synthesize whatever color you want. So if you have a negative value, of course, you are subtracting value and not you don't have only sums of these three monochromatic fluxes. I'm sorry. Okay, to overcome these inconsistencies, the decisive steps were taken in 1931 by this CIE, that is an acronym that stands for the Commission for the Commission Internationale d'Éclairage, that was held in Paris, and the official language was French, through the adoption of new units of measurements and three new reference primaries. So in the CIE system, in order to overcome this imbalance, the units of measurements of the different red, green and blue components using the additive synthesis were modified differently so as to derive new functions of chromatic correspondence between red, green and blue, of course all functions of lambda, of wavelengths, as represented in the following figures, where the values of three stimulus R, G and B necessary to define the sensation of white are equivalent at this point. So the average three stimulus function, red, green and blue in lambda, proposed by the CIE in 1931, resulting from the application of three new primaries, red, green and blue, centered in the following wavelengths: the red in 0.7 microns, the green in 0.54 microns, and blue centered with the dominant wavelengths of 0.43 microns, which ensure the equal distribution of the three stimuli in the definition of white light. So they overcome the first problem, and you will see that they overcome also the second of the issues that I presented before. I'm sorry. Then the CIE adopted three new reference primaries that were closer to the triplet of the additive primary color and blue, and so more distant from the spectral sensitivity peaks of the cones of the human's eyes. So the previous three wavelengths in which they were chosen, the new primaries, were quite different from the spectral sensitivity peaks of the cones. You remember the previous lesson. But the main use of these three stimulus function, this new three stimulus function, because they were using three different primaries, were used in order to contribute to the quantitative determination of a color based on a trichromatic synthesis, RGB, this one, based on the three scalar values of these three stimulus, R, G and B, which include, by definition, also the influence of the other two external parameters that intervene in the process. So I mean, in these three new primary and defining these new three stimulus functions that I remind you are the functions that are translating, which is the energy that comes to our cones, and which is the sensation of our brains is give to this particular radiance in this particular wavelengths. In this Commission Internationale d'Éclairage, they also embedded other two important characteristics: the spectral function of the radiant flux, phi lambda, of the illuminant. So they are also considering the fact that this panel, for example, or the colors, is illuminated by a particular external source of energy, and the reflectivity, that is the rho lambda, or transmissivity, tau lambda, it depends if you are talking about filters, for example, or colors projected on a screen, depending on the case of the observed surface. So they are embedding also the characteristic of the illumination and the characteristics of the reflection of the surface on which these flux coming from the projector are projected. So they are considering also these two conditions. And the impressions of red, green and blue
beginning from the analytical point of view, these things here. So you see, we have three different impressions that are three different curves. And when we are integrating these curves from 0.4 to 0.7 microns on, or for 400 to 700 nanometers, and this is the three stimulus for the red, this is the reflectance coefficient of the surface, that is where, for example, the the color is projected, and phi lambda, as I mentioned before, is the illumination in which we are measuring these things. You remember, we are measuring the three components using these three projectors, so the quantity of energy that is projected in order to have the same color as the reference one that is projected. For the three different colors, we have these three different integrals that are calculating the total radiant energy that is going straight to our cones. So before going on, I'm just checking if we are continuously registering, because otherwise we are in problems. Okay, we are 55 minutes, so I mean, I'm continuing just mentioning these facts here. So it's quite strange to think about the three stimulus, and also the rho lambda and the phi lambda, as we mentioned before, and the meanings is what we mentioned before. But consider that if we are if we are testing with individuals that are observers that have an average sensitivity, color sensitivity, if compared with the total population of human beings. So I mean, this individual is placed in front of the screen in a perpendicular position. This is usually a white screen where is projected these unknown colors. And how you can project these unknown colors? So you can project that using a simply projector, as the three that are used for projecting the three primaries, and these unknown colors is simply the colors that has a filter that is put on the projector. So that means that it will project it on the screen these unknown colors in which we don't know the characteristics, the quantitative and the quantitative characteristics. So just close to these colors that is projected, that is unknown, we are overlap the three rays that are coming from the three other projectors that are filtered by red, green, and blue with the new dominant wavelengths that was decided in the Commission Internationale de Claquage. These three fluxes are overlapped. We are working on the power meters in order to change the emission of every single projector filtered by red, green, and blue, and until the observer, I mean the individual that is observing the colors, will say stop, don't work on the on changing the emission of the three primary, because the colors, the two colors, the unknown and the new one that is projected by aid of the three projectors, is similar. I mean, according to me, that I'm observing that, because I'm the individual, I'm the observer, the two colors appears to be the same. So the unknown and the new formed one. So if that appears to be the same, I simply check the quantity on the three different projectors in RGB, and I will define the triplets of values, that is the quantity of energy that is needed in order to reproduce these things here. Of course, if I'm doing that and I'm projecting these things, of course I need to project that on a white screen. That means that I need, of course, look at the screen, I need the reflection coefficient, and of course the screen that will be whitish will have from 0.4 to 0.7 microns a almost unity value of the reflectance coefficient. So the reflectance coefficient from 0.4 to 0.7 for the screen will be very similar to 1. So all the energy that is striking over that will be reflected back to the observer's eyes. But I also need to do that. Where I'm doing that? Of course I'm doing that this test where the observer is observing this screen. Should be done these things here in a lab, of course. I cannot do that outside, because outside I cannot use the projector, because I mean there's too much light. So I need to perform this this test on in a confined space. So in a confined space, in a lab, so in a room, I need an external source of illumination. And why I need an external source of illumination? I need an external source of illumination because with this external source of illumination, I can simulate different illuminating conditions. And so why that? This is why I need to define this phi lambda. That is the different illumination in which I can conduct these different experiments, in which the observer is considering the similarity of an unknown and the new produced colors in order to understand which are the quantitative contents of the three primaries in the unknown colors. So that's why we need these two different parameters. So going on, the resulting total luminous flux or color stimulus will be given, measured in watt, of these things here. So when we are resolving these three integrals, the results will be a flux that is going to our cons that is equal to the sum of the red, green and blue component times for every single component of this FR, FG and FB coefficient. What are these three coefficients? These three coefficients, of course, are constants and are proportional to the unit quantities of the adopted trichromatic system. I don't understand you, I don't explain to you which is the analytical process for which they arrive to solve these integrals and to define these three quantities. Take it as they are, because these three quantities are what for FR1, for FG4.59, and for FB is 0.0601 respectively. All right, so take it as they are without any other comment. I'm sorry. So the definitive three stimulus that were defined in 1931 are this one. So you see, they overcome at least the second problems, because you see now all the functions are positives. And they were modified in that way, using under three different principle color, in order to ensure the equal distribution of the three stimuli in the definition of white color, in order to keep all the values of the function themselves positive. So that means that, you see, all the functions are positive, so we can sum the three stimulus in order to have the same colors, and you see the white color will have a pure white color. That means with the maximum saturation, that means that we'll have the maximum sensitivity, the maximum three stimulus value, that is the maximum of these three functions. So in these three positions, we will have the maximum three stimulus value for the three principal colors, and if they are the maximum possible, that will be that the resulting color will be the white color. All right, so luminous and illuminant sources. Sorry again. Considering the importance of the spectral and power characteristics of the illuminating radiant flux, the phi lambda that I mentioned before, the CIE, again in 1931, defined some lighting standard corresponding to different light sources. So that's why they test the measures, of course, in a laboratory, and in a laboratory is for definition, by definition, in a confined space. So that means that we need an external source of illumination, and so they decided to perform the test using different source of illumination. And you see, for example, this is the energy emitted by these different sources. You see that they have a very conventional name. The source A, that is the red, for example, the source C, you see, that has an emission in the visible from 0.4 to 0.7, that is the wavelength usual in this diagram. And here we have the energy, so the energy emitted by these sources, that is not, you see, constant, so it's not really a white or a grayish lights, because a very white light will be a line that is parallel to the x-axis here at 100, for example, at top of scale. This is a white light. Here there are all lights that you see, they have a particular dominance. For example, the source A is something that has a reddish component, while the source C, you remember, what is the source B? It's a source that has a maximum in the blue part of the spectrum that is very similar to the light that we have on the Earth's surface coming from the Sun, in which the dominant, of course, is in the blue, that is due to the Rayleigh scattering, to the selective scattering, that is the bluish part of the sky. So this is simulating the daylight condition. Why? So say, you see, is defining with these reddish components, is simulating another natural condition. That is, for example, the condition that we have during daylight when the sun is very low on the horizon. That means, for example, at dawn. You see, during the dawn, the dominant, for example, is not the blue color of the sky, so the blue color, the bluish color, but it's something that is ranging between oranges and red, because there's an interference with the atmosphere, where all the blue part is absorbed, and it's remaining only the longer part of the visible in terms of wavelengths. That means the reddish part. And there you see there are also the emission curves of other sources, for example, what was named D65, D100, and Mercury Arc, and so on, and so on, and so on. So these are the description of the different kind of sources. For example, type A is represent the light of a radiant black body in absolute temperature of these degrees Kelvin. It is equivalent to a source made by a tungsten filament that I mentioned before. See again that it's very similar to the condition that we have at dawn in natural condition. So type D represents the direct light of the sun for an equivalent temperature. And you see, this is all the description of the different illuminant. That you see, they are all representing, as you can see here, condition that you can find outside and not in a lab where the tests are taken. So this is very strange, and make you should pay attention to that, because apart from the fact that, of course, it's not possible to execute this test of comparison of colors outside, of course, because we need to project, they needed to project at that time in the 1931 on a wall. So I mean, you cannot do that outside, so you need a laboratory. But in this laboratory, they were simulated all the illuminating condition you can find outside. Why that? Because I mean, they want to define the characteristics of colors in a quantitative way if these colors are observed in outside condition. So I mean, all these colors I mean, the system is calibrated for observing conures in natural conditions. So that means outside and not in confined space. Why that? Because there's a, I mean, it's quite simple to understand. Because I mean, if you are in a room with a particular kind of illumination, and of course you can have an infinite kind of illumination, but maybe you can use the same lamps, but the fact that these lamps is mounted in different part of the rooms, that means that the condition, if you are observing, for example, your wall, and the lamps is mounted in different geometric position, of course the quantity of energy that is striking over these walls can change. So I mean, we have an infinite possible configuration of artificial illuminant in a confined space. So I mean, it's very difficult to standardize the this condition. Why? If we are simulating with these five kind of illumination the natural condition, of course we solved all the problem. But we solve the problems only if we are looking at this color, if we are observing these colors in natural, so outside. And this is the paradigmatic phase, and this is a paradox, because if we are, for example, choosing a color that we will use to color our walls, for example, of our eyes, we are choosing that using a system that is based on the observation of this color in outside condition. But if we want to color our walls of our eyes, it's of course something that is not dealing with what we are observing outside, and so the results that we will obtain will be different, of course. And so we need to take into consideration all of these things here. So in order to represent, because I mean CIE defined the system in order to standardize the measurements of colors, and in order to standardize these things, the possibility to measure these colors using the three primaries, you need to represent this in particular formats. And for example, here we have particular formats. So for example, one way, and in the figure below, I just considering the left part, the left figures, you can consider the having three coordinates, so the three components of the three principles, that is red, V, that is in Italian verde, that stands for green, and B. You can use, for example, a triangle in order to represent these things. Of course, you can also use something that is more difficult. I don't want to go in depth to that representation of these particular forms or the integration of different forms, of different shapes. So I mean, there are different ways in which you can represent these triplets of coordinates. But of course, that way, they simply realize that using three different coordinates, for example, to represent that in a Cartesian diagram, so you need a Cartesian three axis of course representation in order to represent the three kind of coordinates. So that means that of course it's not very useful to have a tri-dimensional representations, and so they simply they decide to do these things here. So they normalized the three colors, and for example, I mentioned that only for red, the new red is the ratio between the component for that colors measured in red, and is divided by the sum for the same colors of the three components of the three principles, red plus green plus blue. This is a normalization, because these three A, G and B are all comprised between 0 and 1. And of course, the sum of A plus G, plus B, these not capital A, G and B, will be equal to 1, of course, because they are parameters. And of course, if A plus G plus B is equal to 1 after a normalization, that means that, for example, I can simply Knowing two or three these three components, for example red and green, I can define the quantity B as the complement to the unity of the sum of the previous two. So if R plus G plus B is equal to 1, B will be equal to 1 minus R plus G, of course. So that means that only knowing two of the principal colors, I can define the unknown colors or the characteristic, the numerical characteristics of the of whatever color, only using two principles and not the third. And in order to define a very generic system that is not related to these particular principles, they decided in 1931 also to take out any reference to the A, G and B, but defining three unknown coordinates or generic coordinates that are of course X, Y and Z. And I mean, if you are knowing X and Y, you can derive as complement to the unity of the sum on S and Y, also the Z, of course. And so that allows the possibility to represent in a very simple bi-dimensional diagram the characteristics of a colors, of whatever colors you want. And for that, they define this particular diagrams. You see, this is the diagram that is represented, let's say, in black and white, and this is the color one, where you can measure the characteristics of every single colors. But before going through these diagrams, I just want to mention the facts that this diagram represents all the chromaticities visible in the average person. So let's back here. You see, let's mention the colored one, the right one. Look at the mouse. Here you see we have X and Y ranging from 0 to 1. All right, here 0.8, here 0.9. By construction, I don't want again to demonstrate you how they arrive to define this diagram. It's a sort of standardization in order to go through here, but this is a diagram that is called, I don't remember the name in English, okay? It's a sort of horseshoe shaped figure, because it's very similar to this show in Italian, is ferro di cavallo diagram, that is also called the gamut of human vision. You see here in bold. So going back here, you see in this Osho diagram, all the color that a human can see is comprised in these figures here. So by construction, don't ask me why, because it's too difficult. This is not the goal of this course to demonstrate that. Outside of this figure here, so in this white space, there are no colors that human can perceive as colors. So all the colors are here, you see? And you can understand that, I mean, this is based on a trichromatic system, because for example, if I want to understand which are the characteristics of a point here, for example inside the green area, I simply can measure the quantity of X that is let's say around 0.15 here, and the Y that is 0.72, where X is the red and Y is the green, and of course if it is the green, the Y will be bigger. And if this point is in red 0.15 and in red is 0.7, the result is that for the blue component will be again 0.15. that is 1 minus 0.7 plus 0.15, of course. So we will have the characteristics of this particular point of the human gamut here. Alright, in this area, of course, there are infinite points, right? That means that the human eye, is able to perceive as color infinite colors, of course. And you see that in this diagram, by construction, it's also taken into account the different sensitivity of human eyes. Because, for example, you see that the red areas here of red colors that are ranging from red, orange, to purple and violet, this area is definitely smaller than the greenish one you see here, and also the blue part of the spectrum that is here, of course, for lower value of x and y, because the z, that is the correspondent blue, is bigger than the other two. This blue area is very small, and this is done by construction, taking into consideration the sensitivity curves of the human eyes. That means that we have a smaller sensitivity in blue and red wavelengths in comparison with the green. And so now we can fully understand what I mentioned in the previous lecture, in lecture number 6. So having here in this area an infinite number of points, that means that if for every single point we have a particular colors, human eyes is able to perceive an infinite number of colors, because there's an infinite number of points here. But you see, if I'm taking 2 points on this diagram, for example here in the red part of this human gamut, and I'm taking 2 points here at a particular distance, let's say very close, if I'm looking at, if I'm staring on the screen, these 2 points in the red part of the this horseshoe diagram, my eyes in the red part is not seeing any difference. It seems to be the same color, red, with the same saturation, and of course with the same intensity, because to my cons, if I don't see any difference of these 2 points, 2 very close points in the red part of this diagram, if I don't perceive any difference, of course the energy is the same, or at least the sensation that is going to my brain is the same. But if I'm taking these 2 points at the same distance, and I'm shift these points in the green part, it's possible, and it's more probable, that the 2 points at the same distance in the green parts give to our eyes, to our brains, a different stimuli. So that means that it's with the same point distance in the green part of the spectrum, our eyes are observing these 2 green color with 2 different intensity. So they are perceiving these colors as different. And this is the meaning of the different sensitivity in the spectral, in the visible of the human eyes. Because, I mean, it's able to distinguish a more quantity of gray tone, of gray colors, perceived as different colors, in comparison with the blue and the red. And this is the things here. So, in this diagram, you see, if I'm taking a point, I can calculate the coordinates, and so I'm using the RGB system, the additive system, where I'm additioning the 3 components. This is not, of course, these additions are not taken in an algebraic point of view. They are not the sum of 3 components, but is a synthesis of 3 components that is different. But of course, I can also use with these diagrams also the subtractive synthesis, because if I'm taking the position 0.3 here, 0.33 here, Point 33 here, that is the barycenter of the diagrams, and that means that if in the red I have point 33, in the green I have point 33, in the blue I have point 33, so that means three equal components of the primary, the results will be the white color, that is the barycentric point of this diagram. And I can use this barycentric point, as you say, as you seen here, because if I have this point here, look at the left part of the figures, I have this source here that is unknown in X and Y, I can calculate here the three components, the three coordinates, the two coordinates in this diagram, and then I can extract the third one as complement to the unity for the blue one, and this is the RGB system, the additive system, but I also can use the subtractive system, simply connecting in a graphical way this point to the white point here, so that is the barycentric point, extending this line to the contour of the diagram, and this is the subtractive system. So I can subtract from white this color here that I have on the border of the diagram, in which percentage? In a percentage that is the ratio between this distance here, the point unknown to the barycentric point to the white, divided by this distance here. If I'm subtracting the quantity of this color from the white in this with this weight, I will get the quantity in a subtractive system of these colors. So I can use that also in a subtractive system. You have also to see that by construction, again, on the border here of this horseshoe diagram, I have all the saturated colors by construction, all right? And so here I can represent also these colors with the correspondent dominance in wavelengths. So you see that I'm starting here from point 4, that is a sort of saturated blue, to 0.5 and 0.52, that is a saturated green with this dominant, going to 0.7, that will be the dominant color for the red. Alright? So here I have a bunch of things. The last things that you will find also in the explanation, the textual explanation in the next slides, is also this curve here. This curve here, this curve here, is called Planck-Loci. What is the Planck-Loci? Is the curve that is representing the infinite points. That and this is really, I don't understand really why this is called the Planck-Loci, because all these points are the representation in this diagram of the Wien's law. You remember the Wien's law? The Wien's law is simply the ratio of a constant divided by the temperature measured in Kelvin degrees of a black body. So that means that a different temperature of this black body, this is the Wien's law, is calculating the maximum of emission. Alright? So that could be translated in colors. So with this, with a particular very low low temperature, in the visible, the maximum of emission is in the red part of the spectrum. That is moving to the orange, you see, to the yellow, to go into the blue part. All right. When the temperature is too low, of course, the maximum of emission, for example, like for the Earth's surface, is not here, because again, This diagram here is representing only the interval of wavelengths comprised between 0.4 and 0.7, and we know that the maximum of emission for the Earth is in the thermal infrared, so outside this range of the visible. And this is very easy to understand. It could be very useful in order to understand, for example, the colors of fires. For example, when we are burning, for example, woods, the flames are reddish. That means that the temperature of the fire that is coming from a combustion of woods is quite, is not so hot in comparison, for example, with a combustion of gas. Take, for example, in consideration when we are cooking, the flames are blue. And that means that the maximum of emission, what we can catch with our eyes, has a dominant in the blue part of the spectrum. That means that a fire that is combusted using gas is much hotter than the fire that is using wood at combustors. This is very easy to understand in this way. All right? So, in the next slides, you have the description of what I just described. There's nothing more to add in these things here. For example, here you see that you have the white color. This is the conclusion, but before to conclude, I need to specify that there's a question. But this question I will ask you during a virtual classroom. I will ask you these things in a couple of weeks when you will go into this lecture, and I will ask you if, according to you, in this human gamut, all the colors that are perceived by the human beings are in this diagram. So my question is, are we completely sure that in this diagram there are all the color that human eyes could perceive? I will ask you these things during a virtual classroom. Okay, for today is enough. I can close the lecture. Of course, take care, and we all never give up. Bye-bye.